Hello, my name is Pastor Fredy Reinosa, and I am the senior pastor at the Stoneham Memorial Seventh-day Adventist Church on Nobility Hill in Stoneham, Massachusetts. Our church has been serving the greater Boston area for over 100 years through ministry, education, and community service. You can find out more about us at our website, stonehammemorial.org, or visiting us in person at 29 Maple Street. We thank you for joining us here at our weekly church service.
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Amen. We want to welcome you to our church, those who are here, and also those who are watching us online. We pray that as we worship together this morning and as we sing praises to God, that we will be comforted and that we will be encouraged as we prepare to meet Jesus very soon. Okay, let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we want to thank you for being here with us. We thank you for your comforting presence. We thank you, Lord, because we know that we are not alone. And Father, we claim this promise for the Christians and family as they are mourning the loss of Liso. That, Father, that you promised to be close to the brokenhearted. So I ask, Lord, that they can feel your presence even closer during these times. Father, we know that that you care for us, and we know that you are coming soon to take us home. So, Father, help us to have that hope in our hearts so that we will be encouraged as the day draws near. Father, we ask that you can be with our church family, those who are here and those who are watching us online, that you can experience your presence today. It is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. I do have one more announcement. How many of you remember Solid Rock Cafe? So we're going to have that again. We'll start on October 22nd. And the three pillars of our meeting is food, fellowship, and praise. I'm happy to have that again, and I hope to see you there so we can spend that time together. Yesterday when I was choosing songs for this service, I have had a lot of thoughts. I had something that happened with my family this week that made me think a lot about God's protection and also loss and how we can find comfort in God when we go through such difficult times. So the songs I chose for today, and I feel like they're very fitting also as our hearts are heavy this morning on how we have a God that cares for us and is close and just close to us and to our hearts. The first song is Under His Wings, 529. We'll sing all verses. 529. issue him fine 422, marching to Zion.
Sabbath. So today I'm going to talk to you guys about a place I went this summer. Sorry about that. I'm going to talk to you guys about a place I went this summer. Óbidos. So, Óbidos is a really old town in Portugal that has a wall surrounding it and a castle. There. Does anyone remember any cities with walls? The Bible? Yeah. Jericho, yes. So one of the days we were there, we decided that we wanted to walk around the wall. Okay. So on the way up the steps, we almost instantly noticed that there were no railings. Now, it was a little scary at first because there's no railings, but also very unique because you really can't do this anywhere else in the world. And it also gives you a sense of what it might have been like to be there more than 1,000 years ago. So there are also watchtowers. There. Which were also completely open, as you can see. And the floors at the top were only 3 feet wide. So the real problem began when there were more than 2 people trying to go up and down the stairs at the same time. Because there was a more or less 70-foot drop, and I really do not want to be coming home in a wheelchair. So, no. In moments like these, we really have to put our trust in God. You know, while also being careful. But, so, not only ourselves. Trust that God will do his will and keep us safe. No. One of the fun things that we did in Obidos was put on some armor. No. Real armor. It was really fun. I was able to put on a chainmail headpiece and I put on a tunic that I used to walk around the city for about 2 hours. Then we came back, and I got the metal sword and the main chainmail piece, which was only for photos because it's extremely heavy. Now, this also kind of brings me to a verse in the Bible that's in Ephesians 6:13. Which says, "Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand." Now, one of the things that seemed particularly interesting to me while we were there was a visual representation of another Bible verse, which is in Matthew 19:24. One second. Which says, and again I say to you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Now, back in the day, when camels were used to carry people and goods, they would close the main gates at the entrances at night. What people and merchants could use at night were these things called eyes. No. Which were just big enough to shove a camel in with some dedication. No. What we believe that Jesus was saying by that was that we have to leave the physical treasure behind and go get his eternal treasure in heaven. You cannot fit a camel in there with all the stuff loaded on it. You really can't. In Matthew 6:21, it says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Okay. Would any of you like to pray?
Dear Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for this wonderful Sabbath morning you gave. Jesus, pray, amen.
Go back to your seats now.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Our offering today will go to the local church budget. The family was carpooling on their way to their son's graduation in Tennessee when someone asked, "What is ministry?" Someone else asked, "What ministry is most impactful to the community?" The lively discussion paused when the GPS directed them off the highway for no apparent reason. At the stoplight was a man who had a sign asking for food. The temperature that day was close to 100 degrees Fahrenheit. Luckily for us, we got 60 degrees. I like it. The man was turning red and was covered with sweat. He looked as if he were moments from fainting. The driver pulled a sandwich, a dessert cup, and a bottle of water from the cooler. The man shouted that this was an answer to his prayer. He had prayed that the Lord would send food and water so he could survive in the intense heat. That's when the GPS redirected them to the exit. As the family resumed their trip, the driver joined the discussion and stated that this is ministry. When you touch the lives of people, not only to convert them, but to minister to their needs, that is ministry. Each church understands the needs of their community. When you give to the local budget, you are being part of the ministry of the church to reach the community for Christ. What is ministry? Here are the words from Jesus. "Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye did it not to one of the least of these, ye did it not to me." Matthew 25:45. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to give back to you and to the community. Help us to use our money for your ministry and to touch the lives of people, not just to convert them, but to minister to their needs. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Today's scripture reading is found in Malachi chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. Again, that is Malachi chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. And it says, "See, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. He will purify the Levites and refine them like gold and silver. Then the Lord will have men who will bring offerings in righteousness, and the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord, as in days gone by, as in former years." Amen. Please kneel for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful, wonderful day of life. Thank you for giving us the energy to get up and come and praise your name in your holy church. Please bless all the offerings, and please bless the pastor, Lord. Let his message, his words, be with us throughout the rest of the day. At this moment, I especially pray for the Christensen family, Lord. They've been through a lot recently. They suffered a great loss. And that is why I beg for you to be their strength, their courage, and their hope. In your name we pray, amen.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Today I will be singing in the sanctuary. We have a high priest up in heaven. Hallelujah, oh hallelujah. He's our defender before the Father. In a temple made by God, not man. Behind the veil, in a place most holy. Hallelujah, oh hallelujah. Investigating, he cleans the record. All those redeemed by his own blood. He's purifying heaven's temple. Hallelujah, oh hallelujah. In preparation for his returning, for those who love and follow him. He's
my body in the same. second episode.
Sorry, this is not in the program. Pastor Fredy asked us to sing this song. I just want to say first, our hearts are just broken for the Christians and family and the loss of Liesl. And there's coming a time when there be no more night, no more pain, no more death. No more where anybody will have to experience this kind of loss again.
Timeless theme, earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new that day. Gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell. No more night, no more pain, no more tears. Never crying again, and praises to the great. The nations bow down to see the only sound are the praises to Christ our King. Slowly the names from the book are read. I know King, so there's no need to dread. No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never cry. A mansion that's prepared just for me, where I will live with my Savior eternally. And there will be no more night.
It was on a Sunday morning when a voice was heard. And this voice is like you never heard something like this before. It was heard everywhere. This is the voice of Jesus. And it's coming from Joseph's tomb. And in the Sunday morning, Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. It is done. So that Sunday morning, death was conquered. And our destiny was sealed in Jesus Christ. Because as the Bible tells us, that he took our infirmities. And by his stripes, we are healed. Today, I want to talk a little bit about heaven. Because I believe that the promise of the second coming of Jesus Christ is the blessed hope of the church. It is the good news that people need to hear, that Jesus Christ is coming soon. And Isaiah the prophet, when he saw this wonderful day, and he sees himself as part of the redeemed, he says, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him, and he will save us. We will rejoice in the God of our salvation. The Apostle John, in the island of Patmos, when he is seeing all the things that are wrong with the world, and God gives him this incredible vision of the future. And again, he sees the coming of Jesus Christ. And he sees everything that happened at the second coming. And then he sees something even greater than that. What? Is there anything greater than the second coming? There is the third coming. After the millennium, after we've been with Christ for 1,000 years, and in those 1,000 years, we rejoice, but there are still some memories, pain, things that we went through in this world. But Jesus makes everything new. And this is what John saw in chapter 21 of Revelation. Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. It's not that there was no more sea, it's that there is no more sea the way we know it now. Some of us are afraid of getting close to the sea. They're afraid of the ocean. So it won't be like that anymore. Then I, John, saw the Holy City, the New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, amen. No more sorrow, amen. No more crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. And the one who was sitting on the throne said, behold, I'm making everything new. Do you long for that day? God's last day prophet also had a vision of heaven. And this is what she experienced, what she saw. And this is what Ellen White says. We all enter the cloud together. And we're 7 days ascending to the sea of glass. When Jesus brought the crowns and with his own right hand placed them on our heads. Wow, this is Jesus receiving you and I. Remember that Apostle Paul talks that he says, I have fought the good fight. He said, I have kept the faith. I finished the race. Therefore, there is a crown of glory, the crown of life, not only for me, but for all those who await Jesus coming. Are you waiting for Jesus to come? He has a crown for you and for all those who have finished the race. He gave us harps of gold and palms of victory. Here on the Sea of Glass, the 144,000 stood in perfect square. This is what Jesus says. Jesus raised his mighty, glorious arm, laid hold of the pearly gate, swung it back on its glittering hinges, and said to us, you have washed your robes in my blood, stood stiffly for my truth, enter in. We all marched in and felt that we had a perfect right in the city. You belong there because of Jesus. Here we saw the tree of life and the throne of God. Out of the throne came a pure river of water, and on either side of the river was the tree of life. Then something interesting happens. We all went under the tree and sat down to look at the glory of the place, where brethren Fitch and Stockman, who had preached the gospel of the kingdom and whom God had laid in the grave to save them. If you know your Adventist history, you know that Charles Fitch died only a few days before the great disappointment. So these Adventist pioneers died before the great disappointment. So they don't know what happened. They died with the hope that Jesus was going to come in about 2 weeks. That was Charles Fitch. So he's waiting for Jesus to come. So when he dies, there is not a lot of crying because they know that they're going to see their dad and their husband in only 2 short weeks. But then when Jesus didn't return in 1844, then these families start grieving. That's why it is called the Great Disappointment in 1844, because they were waiting for Jesus to come, and he didn't come when they had expected it. It seems that it happened the same also with the disciples. When Jesus died on the cross, even though he had talked to them before, for them, that was a great disappointment, right? Because they were expecting to see Jesus. that Jesus was going to be the king, and they didn't expect him, that he was going to go to the cross. So in the same way, when Jesus went from the holy place to the most holy place, because of the misunderstanding of prophecy, they expected Jesus to come. They were waiting for him. So Ellen White, in this vision of a Stockman and Charles Fitch, she sees them in heaven. And it's interesting, that conversation that she has with them. They have preached the gospel of the kingdom, and whom God had laid in the grave to save them, came up to us and asked us what we had passed through while they were sleeping. We tried to call our attention. We tried to recall our greatest trials. But they looked so small compared with the far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory that surrounded us, that we could not speak them out, and we all cried out, "Hallelujah, heaven is cheap enough." And we touched our glorious harps and made heaven's arches ring. After I came out of the vision, everything seemed changed. A gloom was spread over all that I beheld. Oh, how dark is this world. This world looked to me. I wept and found myself here. I felt homesick. I had seen a better world, and it had spoiled this for me. So in the Bible, Jesus talked to us about this better world, and he described how it will be. And as my friend says in her favorite song, "This world is not my home." We were not created to be here forever. After sin, God prepared a place for us, a plan that there will be another opportunity for us. And as we are here this morning, and as we're thinking about loss, or we're thinking about some of the trials that we go individually, that we go as a church, I want to remind you that there is a better world. That Jesus paid the price. He gave it all so that we can be with him forever. Amen. I loved that when Ellen White says they couldn't remember the trials they have gone through. And you see, the Bible talks about that also. The Apostle Paul, in Romans chapter 8, he says, "For I am convinced that the suffering of the present time are not compared to the glory that will be revealed in us." Are you waiting for that day? I pray that as we think about our life, we can ask Jesus every day to live in our hearts, so he can purify our hearts, so that we will be more and more like Jesus. And all of us who have that hope, that one day we will see him as he is. As I was talking to my children last night and trying to explain to them what happened to our friend Lizzo, I said, when Jesus comes, we're going to look for Lizzo. And that's going to be, that's the reason why heaven is going to be special. Because I know that all of you have lost loved ones. But when Jesus comes, the little ones, he will give it to the parents. That's going to be wonderful. And we will be transformed, because it is necessary that we be transformed. This corruption will put on, will be transforming into a new body. And this mortal body that we have, God will give us immortality that day. And sin will be destroyed forever. And we will be forever and ever with, we will be with Jesus Christ. And that greatest promise is that one day we will see his face. We will see Jesus. He will come and save us. And we will see his face. I long for that day. Do you long for that day? So then, if we long for that day, let's share this wonderful news with others. Friends, this is the blessed hope. This is one of the pillars of our faith. And this is one of the reasons why I am a Seventh-day Adventist. So I pray that all of us during this time, we will be drawn closer to Jesus. Let's pray. Our Father God, we thank you for Jesus. It is because of him that we can be in eternity with you, that we can have our loved ones back, but not just suffering in pain, but with those new bodies, Lord, that you will give us when Jesus comes. Father, we long for that day, but Father, we also realize that while we are here, we have a job to do. And Father, we thank you because you have given us that opportunity, that privilege, that we can share this good news with others. So help us, Lord, to share this good news with everyone, every person that we meet. And Father, we ask for the Christians and family that you can comfort them. Father, please comfort our church in the hope that very soon we will hear also that voice that will go to the graves and will say, I am the resurrection and the life. Thank you, Jesus, for all your promises. Amen.
Number 214, we have this hope.
Father in heaven, Lord, help us also to have this promise, this blessed hope in our hearts that will burn within us, Father, and that will keep us through the challenges in this life. Be with us today, Lord. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Thank you for watching our program today. If you have any questions, please call us at 781-438-2977. Again, that is 781-438-2977. We hope to see you soon in person here at our church on Saturdays for our 10:45 a.m. worship service or for Monday night prayer time at 7 p.m. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.